In a huge respite to devotees, the Supreme Court on July 13, 2020, upheld the rights of the erstwhile royal family of Travancore to manage the affairs of the Sri Padmanabha Swami Temple in Kerala's Thiruvananthapuram. Reversing the 2011 Kerala High Court decision, the court said that, as per customary law, the Shabait rights, that is, the right to manage the financial affairs of the deity, survive with the members of the family even after the death of the last ruler. The ruling ends the legal battle the temple and members of the royal family have fought with the government for decades over control of one of the richest temples in the world. We spoke to Supreme Court advocate Sai Deepak, who represented the chief tantri of the Sri Padmanabha Swami Temple, about the case, and here's what he had to say about the verdict.
So this judgment of the Supreme Court comes in a specially petition that was preferred by the Travancore royal family, specifically the erstwhile ruler as well as the current ruler, against the judgment of the Kerala High Court, which was pronounced in 2011. Now, in that judgment, the Kerala High Court was faced with the question of whether the Travancore family continues to enjoy the statutory relationship which it has with the temple under the Travancore Cochin Hindu Religious Institutions Act of 1950, despite the abolition of privy purses under the 26th Amendment to the Constitution in 1971. So the question was very simple, that once you have abolished the concept of a ruler and all titles were abolished in 1971, does the provision under the Act which refers to the ruler of the temple, or let's say ruler of Travancore, continue to have any validity? That was the basic question before the court. So the Kerala High Court effectively said that thanks to the abolition, all such titles have been rendered redundant, and therefore there is no one who enjoys the status of a ruler with respect to this particular temple. And this has specific consequences, because the moment you come to that conclusion, then the question is who manages the temple. Therefore, the High Court had come to the conclusion that the state government of Kerala should manage the temple. And all the treasures and, let's say, the jewelry of the deity was asked to be put on a public display in an exhibition or a museum of sorts. That was effectively the direction of the Kerala High Court. Against all these points, the royal family preferred an appeal before the Supreme Court, an SLP before the Supreme Court. And on day one in 2011, when the matter was listed before the Supreme Court, a stay was granted on the judgment of the Kerala High Court. The Supreme Court put together a committee of administration until a final decision was arrived at.
Following the verdict, the Travancore royal family welcomed the court decision, saying, "We regard today's Supreme Court verdict as the blessing of Padmanabha Swami, not just for the family, but for all his devotees." Rajya Sabha Member of Parliament Rajiv Chandrasekhar, an intervening petitioner in the case, and the editor of Tughlaq, S. Gurumurthy, too expressed delight following the verdict. So what impact would the Supreme Court ruling have?
The outcome of the Supreme Court's judgment can be summarized as follows. One, that the relationship between the temple and the royal family is independent of any title bestowed by the British, like Rai Bahadur Nawab or Raja or whatever it is, because that relationship is primarily recognized on the basis of a customary practice or a tradition which has pre-existed. And therefore, the abolition of titles under the Privy Purses Amendment of 26th Amendment has no impact on this relationship, because that abolition was only meant to abolish those titles vested by the Crown, the British Crown, on Indians. Okay, so therefore, the traditional relationship of a sevayat, or let's say the servant of the Lord, continues to exist, and the royal family therefore has those rights, and there is no impact of the 26th Amendment on these rights. That's the first conclusion. The second conclusion is with respect to what happens to the administration of the temple. So because these people have specific rights, the court has said that they must play a role in the administration, and the specific role that is envisaged under the Travancore Cochin Hindu Religious Institutions Act of 1950 is that an advisory committee shall function under the supervision of the ruler, under the control of the ruler, and all administrative activities will be carried out. So accordingly, what the Supreme Court has said is that that position has been restored, and along with that, another administrative committee, a 5-member committee, has been formed, to assist this advisory committee and the ruler in the administration of the temple.
Okay.
Now, in the five-member committee, there are three important aspects. One is there is a representative of the Ministry of Culture, the Union Ministry of Culture. There is one representative from the state government of Kerala. The chairperson of this administrative committee will be the district judge of Thiruvananthapuram. In addition to these three members, you have one chartered accountant,
okay,
and you have the chief tantri of the temple also as a member. But for all practical purposes, the administrative committee will function under the advisory committee, and the advisory committee will function under the ruler. Therefore, the ruler is the primary person and the sole, let's say, the sole representative of the administration. Is that the court has said that the opening of any of the remaining wards is left entirely to the decision of the committees, and therefore it is left to the discretion of the ruler of Travancore. And the ruler of Travancore has always taken the position that that Kalarabi was never meant to be opened and should not be opened, because that affects the sanctity of the temple. So this is entirely up to the discretion of the family at this point.